Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Understanding God's Loving Laws group and is part of an Education in Love series. In the Responsibility Principles presentation, Jesus briefly summarizes God's principles of responsibility that govern the operation of God's laws, gives examples of the way these principles are built into God's laws, and answers audience questions about the principles. Recorded on the 22nd of November, 2016, in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
Okay, how are we going? Good? Just get that air in. Let the life remain. That's it. And the subject we're going to discuss now is obviously responsibility principles. Really interesting principle, this one as well, particularly as it pertains to the human again. So we're going to focus on the human soul again and its role here with the responsibility principles. Again, we need to have a look at some terms. So we're going to discuss it primarily, as I've said, with regard to the human. We want to make sure, of course, there is inbuilt responsibility, instinctual responsibility given to other creations, but the human soul is the soul with a self-aware being, the ability to express free will, depending on development. And so that's the one that we want to focus our attention on with regard to this discussion. Energy, development and power still remain the same as they were in our governance principle. So we're still looking at energy being what it is, development being what it is, and power of governance still being the same. So everything's still the same there. But the next page is the interesting thing we need to focus our attention on. So let's have a look at these definitions now that we're adding to the governance principle so that we can define the responsibility principle. Nature. What is nature? Well, nature is each individual human soul's God-given personality, attributes, characteristics, qualities, individuality, and primary fields of interest. All right, so what we're basically suggesting with the definition of nature is that each of you have been created, and remember when we say you, we're talking about the complete soul, not just your half. Each of you have been created with a personality, attributes and character and desires and individuality and primary fields of interest. It doesn't mean that you're not interested in everything, because eventually you do become interested in everything, as you can imagine, but you have areas that you're particularly enthusiastic about. And that's a part of that nature as well. Nature is very interesting because God firstly designed a nature, and then he's basically saying in this principle, I'm going to feed your nature. I'm going to help you enjoy your nature. And so isn't that wonderful? Not, like, what does a parent do when it recognizes a child's nature? Generally, it goes, your nature's different than mine. I don't like that. Bang, bang, bang. You know, if it goes and corrects it to be the same as the parent's nature, right? Well, that's not what God's doing. God's created a nature in the child that's unique, and then he wants to have it grow as part of your expression. So that's a really beautiful thing God's trying to achieve. Now, this is the key. These two things are key definitions now. Self-responsibility. There's a number of factors. The first factor is the law-based requirement. So we're saying here that inbuilt into each law is the requirement that you're self-responsible. That's what we're saying. Right? From God's perspective, he's trying to make you self-responsible. He requires you to be self-responsible. In what areas is the question? He wants you to be self-responsible with regard to self-awareness. So he requires you to be self-aware. So you can ignore it and be not self-aware, but at the end of the day, God's saying, sooner or later, you're going to be self-aware. With my laws, I'm going to make yourself aware sooner or later. Now, if it turns out that it's not on earth and you forget, you don't bother finding out about self-awareness on earth, trust me, come the spirit world and you end up in one of the hills, you'll start to become self-aware. You will. God's made it that way. He's encouraging this state of self-awareness. Now, what is self-awareness? It's to have the feeling, the desire to seek truth, seek love, and seek understanding of all the principles of love and law. Now, you notice I haven't said that it's the perfection of love, truth, and law. I've said it's the desire to seek love, truth, and law. So responsibility is all about your desires, right? It's not actually about what you're doing right now. It's about what do you want to do right now. Huh? And the loving ownership of expression of one's will. In other words, do you have a desire to own your will? Not give it, in previous things we've talked about giving away your will to others. We're saying no. Do you have a desire to own your will? Own the fact that you're a self-aware being with will and actually choose to express your will in harmony with love. In other words, do good deeds. Do things that are good. Is that how you are? Do you desire that? Or what I see in many people still is there's very selfish desires. You know, it's just give me what I want. Don't worry about anything else. Don't do anything good for the planet. Don't do anything good for society. In fact, most of us who are what you would call consumers, the only real thing we do good for society is that we consume so that other people can do good. Right? But say a farmer, he's doing some good, isn't he? Person who builds, he's doing some good. Whatever he's building, some of it can be good, can't it? Like, provides security and safety for people, place to live, comfort, and so forth. That's some good. He might not do it yet in harmony with God's laws, but at least he's doing some good. But for many of us, all we do is use what everybody else does. So we're not doing much good at all. We're just using everything that other people do that are good. So we've got to be careful here, you see. For many of us, we can spend a whole life doing nothing much that's actually good for other people, for the planet, or even a lot of times for ourselves. Yep. And not only is it the loving ownership and expression of one's will, but it's loving ownership and expression of one's desire, passion, emotion, attitudes, intentions, thoughts, and actions. Gee whiz. This is getting to be a pretty comprehensive concept of what it means to be self-responsible, isn't it? All right. And we'll see in regard to the principle how that plays out, how that looks. All right. Now, let's assume that somebody has got to the point where they desire to do this. And I suggest to you at the moment, many of you or most of you don't desire this, really. And you've viewed self-responsibility as, oh, I clean after myself and I cook for myself and I go to work and I do those things. You sort of see that as self-responsibility. And sure, that is a part of self-responsibility, but it's not the complete picture. Do you desire truth or do you repel it? Do you seek love and understanding or do you try to run away from that? Do you desire to use your will, passion, emotion, attitudes, intentions, thoughts and actions in harmony with God's principles or not? Most of us would have to say, well, probably most of the time it's not, right? Now, let's assume, and by the way, you can get into this condition without being perfect. Can you not? Of course you can, because it's about desire. It's not about what you're currently doing. It's about do you desire to do it? So you can get into this condition in the hells if you wanted to, because it's all about desire. It's not about anything else other than desire, really. It's about desire for self-awareness, desire for truth, desire for love, desire to look at my intentions, desire to look at my actions, desire to live in harmony with the principles, even though I may not currently do it. It's about, do I desire to do it? Can you see this is one reason why we've had to remove people from the group? Because we feel there's no desire. Right? This is about desire. So self-responsibility is a lot about desire. Now, assuming we've done that, God can assign us roles. But the way that God assigns a role is he goes, what is that person really like? What's their nature? I'm going to give them a job that they're really going to love. That's what he does. So he doesn't go, oh, you're really self-responsible. I'm going to make you the head of the garbage collectors unless you really love dealing with garbage. And by the way, it might sound funny, but the reality is God has created many souls who do love dealing with garbage, and because they see the importance of that. And if we really understood the importance of it, many of us who don't love dealing with garbage might be wanting to deal with it, right? But God deals with garbage, so he loves it. He's made a whole heap of, in fact, he's made literally tens of thousands of creations on this planet are just for dealing with garbage. So that tells you how passionate God is about it. He's made all these creatures. He's been very specific about the jobs they do, right? Just to deal with our garbage and other things, garbage too. So you could say, so God's the head garbage collector and he's put into some souls, he's put into some souls the desire to be that, right? And if we truly valued the personality and nature of those souls, we'd see their important role, would we not? Right? And so forth. So you can see that it goes from the garbage right the way through to a scientific discovery or whatever else. You know, God's put these desires into us and we need to see that has happened, right? So God assigns the role responsibilities in the universe based upon the development, the self-responsibility, and according to one's nature, those three factors: development, self-responsibility, and according to the definition of nature. Okay, so here we have some interesting concepts now. So what do the responsibilities do for us? These principles. Well, first thing they do is they force the human to be self-responsible. Now, it's one thing to create a creation that's the highest of creations, right? Remember, we've drawn the hierarchy basically. Remember, we started out with two elements making another, and then that element consisting with another and making another, and so far all the way up the chain till we get to the human soul, right? The human soul being the highest of God's creations. So it's one thing to make the highest creation and then to give that highest creation the power of governing other creations, isn't it? So now that creation can govern all the other creations, and that's wonderful to do that. But how does he govern? Well, let's say he governs badly. Can you see, unless there was some feedback mechanism for him, this soul, this combined soul, demonstrating that actually you're out of harmony with principles here when you govern, unless there's some way of making him responsible for how he's governed, can you see the whole thing would fall in a heap? Right? So the human needs to be responsible for how he's governing. So God's created this, which is an injection of the concept of desire and an injection of the concept of compensation into governance. And we'll talk about desire and compensation later, but that's what this principle does. It combines many other principles to allow the human to actually govern and then also be responsible for the outcomes of its governance. It engages the humans to desire self-responsibility. So it encourages it. And the reason why it encourages it is because it's basically, God's basically saying, when you're self-responsible, the compensation principles, which is another factor of it, will give you some rewards for self-responsibility. And when you're not self-responsible, the compensation principles will give you some corrections for self-responsibility. Right? Both things are loving, of course, but one will be rewarded, the other will be corrected. And he encourages it by making laws that actually make you self-responsible and be compensated for self-responsibility. That's how he encourages it. So it allows God to reward true self-responsibility with a role responsibility. In other words, role responsibility is a compensatory gift given to those with self-responsibility. So role responsibility is, you could say, a reward given to those with self-responsibility. That's how God rewards it, one of the ways God rewards it. Besides, of course, compensating for every bit of self-responsibility we engage. Okay, now is there any specific questions? Obviously many of you asked questions about even those things, which I'll just grab here. Okay, now one thing I would like to mention, and just go back the other way, to the self-responsibility definition. The key to understanding this principle is to understand that definition. And it's all based on desire, right? Faith, future feelings, what you can do in your future, right? So it's all based on this desire motivating you to it. So it's not based on the fact that are you doing it right now? It's based on, do you want to do it? And are you going to do it? Right? So for many of us, we're not self-responsible right now, right? We'd have to agree we're not. From God's point of view, we're not. But what do you want to do about it? Are you going to fix that problem? Or are you just going to keep doing things the same way you've always done them? What are you going to do? That's the real key, isn't it? Yep. So Sandra, you'd like to ask?
So basically it's all about faith, because desire and faith is the same. So having that desire for future growth.
Yeah. Yeah. So a lot about faith, isn't it? This principle. And faith being rewarded as well. So God's not trying to just force you to self-responsibility without there being rewards for doing it. He's trying to reward you as well. But he's also showing you that when you don't have desire for self-responsibility, you are out of harmony with many things then, right? So what I find is the majority of people have very little desire for self-responsibility, very little desire. But if you can develop a desire for self-responsibility, which is, desire is a part of the self-responsibility definition, in fact, if you can develop a desire to do those things, to seek self-awareness, to seek truth, to seek love, to seek understanding, can you see it would change the way you do a lot of things, wouldn't it? So whenever we gave you some truth, do you think you'd all be going, hope he says less next time. Hope it's not me. People are going, is that me? Can you see that? It'd be like, I don't know if it's me or not. Can you tell me? Wouldn't you? You'd want to know, wouldn't you? If you desired truth, wouldn't you want to know? Of course you would. But what I see everybody going, I hope he doesn't look at me about that, right? This is not a lack of desire for a lack of self-responsibility. It's a lack of desire, therefore a lack of self-responsibility. A lack of desire for truth is a lack of self-responsibility. A lack of self-awareness is a lack of self-responsibility. A lack of desire to love is a lack of self-responsibility. Can you see what we're really saying? It's all about the responsibility. There is all about the desire to do what is right and good and what will benefit you and others. It's all about the desire. It's about letting yourself examine your desire. And in fact, it's a law-based requirement to examine your desire. In other words, the laws are going to force you to look at your desire sooner or later. So remember we said before that in other principles that the law measures mathematically your thoughts, and it measures mathematically your emotions. It measures your current attitudes. It measures what's going on inside of you with regard to the flow of energy. That being the case, the laws all measure your self-responsibility, interestingly. Right? They're measuring it right now. All the laws are measuring it. Your self level of self-responsibility. Elvira, up the back, thanks.
Is it possible to reject compensatory rewards?
Is it possible to
reject compensatory rewards?
Of course it is, yes. Your soul, at soul level, is very difficult, but you can consciously attempt to do so, certainly.
And that's very unloving.
To yourself, yes.
To yourself.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, particularly when those rewards are, like, could mean major changes for the rest of your life. It's very unloving, isn't it? That's why the sin against the Holy Spirit, which is actually a reward of self-responsibility to seek God's love, is actually a large sin. So you want me to say that to you again? The allow you desiring God's love, can you see that's an act of self-responsibility? Right? And if you reject to seek God's love, you don't desire to seek God's love, can you see the damage that particular lack of desire is going to cause the rest of your existence? That's why it's such a large sin. It's going to stop you from your potential. Your future potential forever is stopped by that one decision. So this is where it's so important to understand that self-responsibility is the area that many of us need to spend a lot of time and work on, right? Because it is the area that is severely affecting our future life. Yeah. If we come down to Bart, thanks.
Role responsibility, I can see in the spirit world how it would be automatic, but on the earth plane it doesn't seem to be so automatic, or when it's not as obvious.
When you say automatic?
My understanding is, and I could be wrong, in the spirit world, if you had a desire or you took responsibility to a certain level, that a role, if you had a role, a desire for a role associated with that level, it would be automatic for you to.
No, it wouldn't.
It wouldn't?
No. In fact, if you have a desire for a role, then you're already out of harmony, with self-responsibility. Why is that?
Because you're not honouring the principle of love.
Well, there's a lot of principles you're not honouring, isn't there? Love being one of them. But what happens on earth when we desire roles? Usually, firstly, we're not in a state of love when we desire it. Isn't it true? And so what do? We usually want power then. And then we're usually grasping for power, attempting to gain power over another. And as a result of that, are we in a self-responsible condition? No, we're not. So from God's perspective, we're not even yet self-responsible. So the so-called desire for a role, you don't desire roles and then get them. That's not how you get them. Yeah. Many of you would like it to be that way. Does that make sense? But that's not how God assigns roles. God assigns roles based on what, three things? There's three requirements, not one. There's development, One. Two is the self-responsibility. Two. And then the third one is according to one's nature. Three. So there's three ways, all combined, that cause God to assign a role. Right? So he just doesn't go, does Barb want the role? Yes, I'll give it to her. Yep, we'll save the mic back. That's fine. You seem troubled, Barb. So we'll just deal with your troubles.
Thank you, but I probably didn't explain myself too well.
I feel you explained it well enough. What do you feel you haven't explained?
My concept of the spirit world was that with all of those things in play, that automatically those roles are assigned to you, those three things you just mentioned, self-responsibility.
But who assigns them? Do you?
God. No, God does.
So you have a waiting attitude on God to give them to you. Can you see the difference between that and a desire to get them?
Yes. Yeah.
What I've found myself is that I've never received a role until I'm actually ready to actually engage that role. Does that make sense? Yep. So that's the way it always is. You have to, God first wants you to get ready before God can give you the role. Ready means, is your development high enough to accept that role? Is your self-responsibility engaged? And what's your nature? Do you like the role? Would you like it? And when I say like it, is it a part of your nature to go to discover these things? Or is it just something you're not interested in at all? What is it, you see? And God looks at it, those three things.
So in the earth plane, do you feel that that's as obviously happening as it does in the spirit world?
Yeah, I do.
It is.
Yes. It doesn't happen between interactions with humans because we all break the principle. And so what do? We assign roles to people who feed our addictions. We assign roles to people who trigger our fears. Anybody demands something, if they're angry enough, they'll probably get the role. That's what we do because we're scared of them, right? We give roles to people for different reasons, but none of the reasons are that the person's self-responsible. You see this happening all the time with, say, gurus, right? And many of you have tried to treat me like a guru, and this is an issue. So what do I mean by with gurus? Well, many gurus on the planet have a terrible personal life. They leave destroyed relationships one after the other, after the other, after the other, right? They barely care for themselves, many of them. They rely on other people caring for them, a lot of them. They're not responsible for their day-to-day choices and decisions, many of them. They have other people who do all that for them. And then you give them a role in your life, saying, oh, what that person's telling me is so amazing. I'm just going to do whatever they say. That's what you do, right? Completely out of harmony with this principle. Because if you looked at their personal life and truly examined it, you go, wow, this person's just like spirit influence saying a lot of stuff that I like. And he's feeding my addictions. I remember one lady, we were at a group, she said to me, you're definitely not Jesus. And I said, oh, why do you feel that? She said, because I don't feel good when I'm with you. Yeah, that tells me a lot, right? My responsibility is to make her feel good. No, it's not. My responsibility is to tell the truth, seek awareness, seek love and understanding from God's perspective, not to feed her addiction of wanting to feel good. Now, she's only ever listened to people who feed her addiction to feel good. Now, the reality is I know what addictions you have that will make you feel good. So I could choose to feed them if I was out of harmony with love, couldn't I? And gain a lot of power as a result. That's not the right thing to do, though. The right thing to do is to live in harmony with God's principles, right? So you've got to be very careful here. We frequently give roles on earth just totally based upon our own addictions, our own expectations, and in particular, the feelings we want from other people. Right? And when somebody doesn't give you that feeling, we get challenged. And then we go, well, I'm not giving him anything. Don't we? Take that away from him. And on top of that, give him a few kicks while he's down as well. You know what I mean? We do that because we are angry when somebody doesn't meet our addictions. And that's not what this is all about, obviously. Here, role is all, if you're truly self-responsible, seeking truth and love, in a relationship with another person, you would never meet their addictions, ever, period. No matter how traumatic your own personal life would get, you would never meet their addiction, period. And what that means then I'm being self-responsible when I'm in that my relationship with that person. Now, God can assign me a role, right? Now, what I've noticed in my own life is that the roles that I've had get assigned because, firstly, I've learned self-responsibility. And in this life, I've been self-responsible since a very, very young child. So by the time I was 5 years of age, I had three jobs that I was working. By the time I was 12, I was earning as much as my father was when I was working. That's been the case ever since. Like, because I feel this very strongly inside of myself, the need for this, be the self-responsible person who's seeking truth, seeking love, seeking self-awareness, seeking to care for themselves completely, not make anybody else responsible for their emotions, their feelings, their addictions, nothing. And the beauty of doing that is then you get rewarded with role responsibility from God. So what I've found for myself with the roles we've been rewarded, myself and Mary, is that we've had to learn this principle, like it's become a very strong part of our nature as a result. And as a result of that, we've had the blessing, the gift, a specific gift from God of getting roles that we wouldn't have otherwise had. Does that make sense? Yeah. So I don't see those roles as a given. They are God's gift to me and to Mary for a number of reasons. And of course, all those reasons have revolved around our choices as well. Yeah. Yeah. Does that make sense, Karen, you'd like to ask?
That makes really good sense to me, but it just occurred to me, if I want to follow my desire, and my desire is to, takes me to a role, am I not assuming a role that I would otherwise be given by God?
Well, if you follow your desires with passion, In other words, you're doing it in harmony with love, truth, and the principles that we've introduced to you, then can you see that one of the feelings you will have is a feeling of humility? So you're not expecting a role. So when I started connecting to God in the first century, I didn't expect a role from it. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. That wasn't my expectation at all. In fact, I was looking around for somebody else to have that role. So like, this is what happened in the first century. I was going, I was very young and started, you know, my education in Egypt. From 5 to 10 or 12 years of age, I was looking at different things like, you know, how, you know, what I saw in the Bible about love and those kind of things and truth and the importance of it, what you call the Bible now, but of course we didn't call it that. But in the end, I came to see like, oh, I want this. I can see that in the Bible there's this thing, this relationship with God. And in the prophets, and the books of the prophets in particular, some of the prophets talked about love and how God would soften up the heart of the human and so forth. I thought, wow, this sounds real good to me. So that's what I want. I'm going for that. And so I started developing my life in that track, right? But all the while, my father was telling me, oh, there's the Messiah thing. And I'm going, it's not me, don't be silly. You know, it's got to be someone else. We've just got to find him, right? So that was my thinking. We'll find him sooner or later, you know. get down the track and I'm 15 and 16, I'm still looking around for the Messiah. I can't find one, you know. And then by the time I got to about 18, I'm going, oh no, it's me. And that's how I felt. Like, what? Surely not, you know. And then it took from 18 to 31 to convince me. So it took me just a few years to get this stage recognizing that it was me. And then it took me another like 12 or 13 years to convince me that it was me, right? But what I found during that phase was that every time I tried to act like it wasn't me, there's things that happen that God's going, no, it's you, no, it's you. And I'm going, no, I don't want it to be me. It has to be somebody else, right? And in a lot of ways, we're still, Mira and I are still in that state now, like doing, working through the same kind of emotions again. And many of the 14 are in that state too, where they're going, what, me? You've got to be joking. It can't be me, it must be someone else. But as they activate their desires, the knowledge of that will come to them directly from God, of course. God assigns the roles, remember? So God does that. So by the time I become at one with God, I realised that the so-called foretold Messiah was me, but I also understood what the role was as well. I understood what he meant by being the Messiah. It wasn't some thing that my father thought, which was some guy that come along and, you know, break the oppression of the Romans and set up the Jewish state, you know, and rule as a king and a priest in the Jewish state, you know, get rid of all the priesthood and so forth. You know, that's why my father, in fact, got partially interested in the priesthood, in the Sanhedrin himself, because he thought that he'd be able to assist me in the role that he thought I would take eventually. And I knew it wasn't ever going to be that way, because God had not only assigned me the role, but God first educated me about what the role was. Do you follow?
Yeah.
Yeah. And this is how God deals with us. He educates you about what your role is before he assigns you the role. And trust me, you'll go through, if you're really sincere about it, you're going to go through, you're not going to be going, I want that role. You'll be absolutely, you know, surprised that you've got the role. You will, just like we have been. And, you know, that's the case because frequently you don't believe you're capable of the role God's assigned, even. Yeah.
So it's really crucial that the desire is engaged with humility.
Yes, yeah. And in fact, true desire involves humility anyway. Because remember, it's to seek truth, to seek love, and to seek the loving ownership and expression of one's will, attitude, passions, emotions, desires, intentions, thoughts, and actions. Now, to do that, you're going to have to be a pretty absorbing person. What I mean by that is you're going to have to absorb your environment pretty well. That means you being humble. So. You know, it's going to require a lot of humility to get to that stage of having self-responsibility. Yep. Good question though, Karen. You had another question too. You want to ask that about parent question?
I can't find the exact bit of paper I wrote it on.
No worries. I've got it here, so I'll read it for you. If a person becomes a parent without consciously attending to, is God rewarding self-responsibility with role responsibility? Or does it all depend on the person's choices with regard to the rearing of the child? Interesting question, right? With regard to parents and parenting and children. So let's have a look at this question in terms of how it all plays out. So, who's the parent of your child? Oh. So God is the person who has the role of parenting his child, of which, for whom you created a body, two bodies actually, to express itself. So let's first define the roles here. the role responsibility is never going to be yours. Does that make sense to you? Why? Because it's not your child. It's God's. You follow? So with a child, that child is God's child. You only created the bodies through which it can express itself. And by the way, you only did that with a, what, how long, how many seconds did that take? Right? If you look at it, it's really only the ejaculatory period and thereafter where it occurs, is it not? Where the commingling of the egg and the cell, the sperm, get together. So that wasn't very long, was it? And it might have been sitting in the fallopian tubes and eventually, get impregnated that way for might be even a half a day or a day, but it wasn't very long still. And all you did was utilize the laws that were inbuilt in the sperm and inbuilt in the egg, did you not? Along with some desire to have some fun, hopefully. Unfortunately for many, that's not the case. And that's what created the bodies. So you barely had anything to do with it, to be frank. Barely anything to do with it at all, right? So God has the role of being the parent to the child, to this child. All you did was create the bodies through which the child can express itself in the physical and metaphysical universes. That's all you've done. So then the question, if we examine the question, if a person becomes a parent without consciously intending to, are they a parent? No. They are the creator of two little bodies for the child of God to incarnate. So they're not the parent. They're a co-soul, are they not? They are just another soul. So here's the parent soul here. It just happens to hopefully be developed. But unfortunately, what's happened with most parents is that they have not developed in harmony with the principles, and so they are actually, in most cases, less developed than the own child that they are bringing to the bodies they've created for them, right? So that's a problem, yes? Now, if we just had this concept in our mind that actually the role of the parent is God's, all I am now is what? I'm an educator. That's my role. I've got this new child of God that is now my responsibility. And if I was self-responsible, I would have a desire for self-awareness and I would lovingly express in my will, I would take responsibility, self-responsibility, in fact, not role responsibility, it's self-responsibility, to actually now guide this child as an educator. That's my role. Now that's a role that God has gifted me, right? To be the educator. Now, can I really be the educator if I'm not self-responsible? I can't. So from God's perspective, he just goes, all you did is create the bodies. You're not even the educator from my perspective, right? All you are is just, so God is not it. God's not assigning the role. You took it. You took it without consideration of the effects of you taking something that you're not ready for. Does that make sense? So don't get it confused as being a parent is God giving you a role. It's not. It's you stealing a role that actually rightfully belongs to God and also abdicating your role as an educator because you lack self-responsibility. Can you see that? Now, a truly self-responsible person who brought into the world these two bodies, and that's all you've done, you haven't brought the child into the world, you've brought the two bodies by which the child can incarnate. So a truly responsible person would go, this is God's child, that's now in these bodies that I've made. And I have, because I chose to do this, And if I'm truly self-responsible and self-aware and truly exercising through the loving expression, my will and desires, I would say I now have the role of educating this child in harmony with what God wants me to educate the child with. That's what I would do. And I wouldn't treat the child as my child. I would treat the child as someone I need to educate, because that is the responsibility I have for myself to do. Does that make sense? It's a self-responsible position to educate this being. Now, if it turned out that you go, wow, I am not ready to educate this child, what would you do? You would give the child to somebody else who is ready to educate the child, if somebody wanted to educate the child. So in the spirit world, there are like, there's some places I know that have got 2,000 children and not a single person there was a person that was a parent, the so-called parent, as we call them, the person who created these bodies. Not a single person who's looking after those children is the creator of their bodies. Not a single person. Because, and I also feel that needs to be the case here, by the way, because some people are just not capable of educating the very little being they've created a body for in the world. They're not. And if you're truly self-responsible, you would say, I'm not capable of this. I've chosen to give birth. I can't not do that because the life principles would preclude me from aborting the child. So I let the child be born, and then I decide, am I ready to educate this child? Do I want to educate this child? Am I going to do something about educating this child in harmony with God's love and principles? Or do I need to seriously look at what I can do to give this child to somebody else who feels they are ready? Yep. And none of us in society would look down on that as a choice or decision. None of us would look down on it. That makes sense? And at the moment, most of us had a huge amount of judgment about that. A mother's given away her child. No, a mother has been responsible enough to realise that she's not ready to educate this child. Right? This is a much better way of seeing it, is it not? We'd have far less judgment about it. Now, of course, we would also need, if we were truly self-responsible, we would also need to do something about the fact that we chose to bring a child into the world that we weren't ready to educate. Wouldn't we? Part of self-responsibility would be to seek self-awareness and to see that, because of a number of decisions I personally made, I chose to bring a child into the world that I wasn't ready to educate. Now, that's an unloving choice, isn't it? Why did I do that? And there's all sorts of reasons why we might do that. Some of them mistakes, some of them sexual immorality, some of them out of harmony with ethics and so forth. And we would address those particular issues. A self-responsible person would address those issues. Mm. Good question though, isn't it? Because you can see all the different factors involved with how this works, this self-responsible consideration of self-responsibility. Now, okay, it's 20 minutes of questions to go. That's good. Okay. Now, that brings me to Joyce. Could we have the mic with you, Joyce? And put up your hand so that Max knows where you are. And Courtney, could I do two of your questions? Thanks. Both one and two of yours. Thanks. Okay, Joyce. Hand up. Yep. Nobody. Don't assume everyone knows who you are.
Do we give role responsibility to each other and ourselves?
Can you just say it a bit louder and slower for us, Joyce?
Do we give role responsibility to each other and ourselves, and or is this more or less just a gift of God, from God?
Yes. So this is basically saying, well, I know in the spirit world that, you know, God will give these gifts of role responsibility. And by the way, that doesn't happen in the hells. People take responsibility in the hell, so it's not always the case. But he's basically saying, well, I think that that's what happens in the spirit world, but here it's not practical. It's basically what the presumption is. And so do I give it to you? Or do you give it to me? Or what do we do with our role responsibility? No, I've stated quite clearly here the way an assignment is made of a role. So the way you demonstrate to God that you're ready to get a role assigned by God is that you become completely self-responsible. And by the way, can you see part of your self-responsibility is to connect to your nature? Because without it, you don't know the role. So part of the self-responsibility is you're going to have to connect to the nature that you have, the attributes, qualities, characteristics, individuality and primary fields of interest. You're going to have to know them. Can you see that? Yeah. And once you've done that and you've developed self-responsibility, you will have feelings from God of what he wants you to do and why. You will. So God will assign them. Now, let's say I am trying to get something done and I respected the fact that God will assign them. And let's say, but I know I'm not going to have the role, let's say, what do I do then? I have to wait until people demonstrate self-responsibility. They start to see their own nature and their fields of interest. They are developing. And then as I notice that, I can see, that person's developing. I can see their nature. And a lot of times you can see their nature from day one, but I can see their nature, they are developing, and I can see their specific roles of interest with regard to the nature, and they are now becoming self-responsible. Let's see what God does with that. And if I can notice what God does with that, then I can say, can you come and do, I'll help them in that role. Does that make sense? I will assist them in that role. So that's how I selected all of the people I've ever selected, and that's been, by the way, quite a few million of people for specific roles. Does that make sense? And the way I did it was by being told by God who would have the role. I didn't do it going, I like Nikki, I think I'll give him that role. Oh, I like Kathy, I think I'll give her that role. But I don't like Rani. Sorry, Rani, don't like you. I'm not giving you any role, no matter what development you have. You know what I mean? That's not how it works. It doesn't work like that. In fact, the person who truly God-reliant would never do that. What you do is you're waiting for God to demonstrate to you through a number of things, each one of these things, nature, self-responsibility and development. You're examining everybody around you. So this is why many of you have not been given roles in divine truth, for example, because you've not demonstrated one or more of those three things. And therefore, like I'm waiting. I know for many of you what you're going to end up doing. God knows exactly what you're going to end up doing. And so if I'm connected to God, don't you think he can tell me? Of course. So I know what many of you will end up doing. But the question is, how long is it going to take before you do it? You know, I might be dead and so might my children and their children be dead before you decide. I don't know how you're going to exercise your desire tomorrow to change that choice or decision you're currently making today. God does, of course. God can predict right down to the second when you're going to do it, because he mathematically can measure everything, being infinite and therefore omnipotent. But I'm not. I'm limited, just as you are, so I've got to wait till the signs are there. And for many of you at the moment, the signs aren't there. So what I've got to do is create like a volunteer program to see who I can sort of encourage along the way or whatever. Do you see what I'm saying? There's things you can do to assist people to get to the state where they realise what they really want to do. It makes sense, doesn't it?
Yeah.
You can do things. You can create an environment that nurtures the desire or nature in the person, nurtures their desire to step up and demonstrate self-responsibility, and nurtures their desire for development. And then you can start recognising, that's who God's got mind there. So with the educational side of things, I can see who God's got in mind. Right? Some of you haven't even engaged that desire yet at all, but you can feel it in the person. You can feel their nature. But at this stage, it's just an opportunity. Remember Mary said this morning about lost opportunities. Yeah, many of us lose opportunities. I'm sure before I came along in the first century, there were other people who could have taken the same opportunity to be the first person who ever received God's love. Does that make sense? But they didn't. Right? Now, if I didn't, sooner or later somebody after me would have, would they not? Sooner or later, somebody would have taken that opportunity. But I am so fortunate I took the opportunity because it's given us so many gifts that we would never have been ever given ever again. If somebody else had the opportunity, they would have got those gifts. And a lot of those gifts relate to the what happens to the joy of experiencing role responsibility and what interactions and that you finish up having with people that you would never have had if you didn't have that gift. Does that make sense? It's like, it's amazing. Like there's a lot of beautiful things that can come your way just because you had some self-responsibility, you recognised your nature, you engaged it with desire, and you really did it in harmony with love and truth. And now, because of that, you get a lot of gifts that are actually gifts. They're actually things that you would not have received if you didn't exercise that. Yeah. And I feel that's something, I see a lot of people coming up to me in groups going, oh, what do you think, you know, what role, what's my specific role, or what do you think my passion is, and why you keep asking me, I do not know. Because while I might know what they are, you've got to know. This is part of self-responsibility. You've got to know what they are. You've got to work it all out. You've got to connect to God, see what he's telling you you need to be doing, and you've got to take actions to do it in harmony with love and truth, right? Then, if it happens to be involved with something that I'm doing, I'll recognize it because God will tell me as well. Does that make sense? And we'll probably work together on the project or whatever. That's what will happen. But it might be something completely unrelated to what I'm doing, and as a result of that, I might not have much to do with you. And it's not because I don't want to have much to do, it's just because you're so interested in what you're doing with other people that you never see me. Do you know what I mean? And that's okay too, isn't it? Because in the end, if you're engaging it in harmony with God's principles here, what you do will benefit the rest of the world and all other souls that exist in the universe in the long run. Interesting concept, isn't it? Self-responsibility, role responsibility. Interesting concept. Okay, who are we next? Thanks, Courtney.
How can we develop more desire for more self-responsibility?
I think there's a bit of a misunderstanding in the question. Can you see it? Self-responsibility is desire.
Yep.
For awareness, truth, love and understanding and so forth. So the way to develop it is to go, okay, what's stopping me from having a desire for these things? Right? So what's stopping you having a desire for self-awareness, for example? What's stopping you to have a desire to seek truth? What's stopping your desire to love? You know, what's stopping you from owning your expression of your will? Why do you give away your will rather than expressing your will? Why is it, you know, what's stopping you from having attitudes, actions, tensions, thoughts in harmony with God's principles? What's stopping you? Right? So one of the first things I would do is address what's stopping me. Right? Now you can see straight away that addictions are stopping you. You can see fears are stopping you. But also there's desires out of harmony with love that stop you as well. Right? So you can see that addressing those is going to have a large effect on what you finish up doing in that regard. So look at what's stopping you there. The second thing is to examine your nature. That means you have to get to know you. You have to discover you properly. You have to get to know you and understand what it is that you really want to do with your life. What is going to bring you the most joy? And what is it? What part of your character and nature is it? See, at the moment, most of us have a very suppressed nature. And for yourself, where you've got a mother like you've had and still have in your life, she's suppressing your nature to a large degree. So you're going to have to work through that so that you can start to feel what is my nature rather than what does mum want me to do. Does that make sense? Now I've got two parts of the equation sorted. I've got the nature part where I know what I really like, what makes me come alive. And on the second part, I'm taking this self-responsibility, this desire to seek love and seek truth and be self-aware. I'm now taking that. Now I'm really doing that. Now the third part of the equation is development. Remember that word, development? Okay. How can I develop in love? Well, how do I do that? I do that by receiving God's love. That's the fastest way to develop in love. So let's look at my relationship with God, focus on receiving love from God. And that's going to help me also with the other two things. Receiving love from God will help me discover my nature. It'll also help me to be more and more desirous of truth and more self-responsible. And so seek this love from God. And as I'm doing those three things together, what will happen? I'll discover who I am. I'll discover that I'm self-responsible. I now have these desires. And I'll also discover I've got some development, and in the process of that, I'm able to communicate with God, and God's able to communicate with me and say, Courtney, this is what I want you to do for me. Do you want to do it? And you'll go, by that stage, you'll be going, damn it, that is just what I was thinking I should do. Does that make sense? Like, you know, you'll know that's exactly what you wanted him to say you wanted to do. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So therefore you'll want to do it. Yeah. Mm-hmm. As a result. So that's what I would do.
Thank you.
Good question though. Your question number two as well, thank you.
Why do humans often not find joy in self-care?
Well, yeah, this is an interesting question, right? In terms of why don't we enjoy self-care? I feel there's a lot of addictive reasons surrounding our definition of love that causes us to not enjoy self-care. For many of us, we don't care for ourselves because we think it's an act of love when somebody else cares for us. So we sort of have this warped definition of love that says, you caring for me, so like David caring for me, hello David, caring for me means you love me. And then if I badly need to feel loved and I don't love myself, I'll go, I need you to care for me so that I feel loved, right? So now what am I doing? It's in my interest under those circumstances, not real interest, but I'm saying addictively, it's in my interest that he cares for me because then I feel all gooey and love, oh, he loves me. You know what I mean? But it's actually out of harmony with God's definition of love. So the main reasons why we don't enjoy self-care is because our viewpoints of love have been distorted, particularly in our childhood. This has happened, obviously, where we start to see these concepts of if someone sacrifices themselves for me, then they love me. Not I do everything I need, but rather they give away something they need for me, then they love me. You know, we have all these distorted concepts of love that cause us then to resist self-responsibility. We start rejecting self-responsibility. We start walking away from it then. And the problem with that is that we will then never find any joy either because we're actually not self-responsible. And true self-responsibility creates joy in our life. Yeah, so it's an interesting... But there are literally thousands of emotional injuries that can potentially cause us to not desire the care of ourselves. Potentially, so we can't list them all, obviously. Could you also ask your next question?
Why do humans often desire people being in societal power and authority who are not self-responsible or developed in love?
Yes, now the answer to this question is very much linked, remember, to the power issue in governance that we talked about in the previous, in the governance principles. Remember the little soul who wants power and the other many, many, many souls who want to give him power, right? Why do these souls here want to give him power? Remember what that was?
The fear.
There was fear.
Addictions.
Addictions.
Condescension, or that was a feature.
So he's projecting stuff there.
Approval.
He's making you feel smaller and you agree with him. Yeah. So that's really about worth, isn't it? You agreeing with his assessment of your worth. Yeah? So you look at someone like... the new president, what's his name again?
Trump.
Sorry, he'd be Trump, that's right. It's been so much in the news, I shouldn't forget the name. So he's a master at attacking people's worth, feeding their addictions and feeding their fears. Right? So he's really good at it. You know, he's learnt it a lot in business. So he's going to be quite a successful politician under today's circumstances because of his ability to feed these particular things. Of course, from what I've observed, he's no... worse than the majority of politicians who do exactly these things. They just feed it with different groups. You know, this man is feeding it with the larger group of white America at the moment. But the other politicians that come before him have fed it in the African American community or fed it in women or whatever. It's no different. It's just, do you see, it's just all the same thing just regurgitated over. So it's no... like I said, he's not. He, in fact, in some ways, he's more developed than the others because he's least truthful about it. Whereas the others are not even honest about it. Does that make sense? So here, there we are. We've got these things going on now. So the question was again, if you examine the question again,
why do humans often desire people being in societal power and authority who are not self-responsible or developed in love?
So in other words, why do we want him to be there rather than someone else who would be more loving be there? Well, you can see why. The more loving person won't agree with your fear, the more loving person won't feed your addictions, and the more loving person will tell you you're worth more than you think you are. And that's why you don't want him. You would rather have someone who feeds your fear and tells you that your fear is good and right and, you know, agrees with it, and someone who feeds your addictions so that he gives you all the nice things that you really want, and someone who basically says that you're not worth as much as him and he's better than you. That's the kind of person you want.
Can I ask, why do we not want people to tell us we're worth more? Why is that something we don't want?
Well, I'm not saying tell you you're worth more.
Oh.
I'm saying that it treats you like you're worth more.
Why and we don't want that.
No, you don't. Why is that? Mary, you want to answer that?
Well, sometimes that triggers our grief and sometimes that encourages us actually to be more self-responsible and we're already resisting that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So there's a whole heap of things we get out of believing we're less worthy.
Yeah.
Including to avoid emotion.
Yep.
Right? Avoid grief from childhood which says we were less worthy. And also, as Mary said, the other things regarding... staying small and so forth. We want to stay small because we don't want to have self-responsibility. We don't want it. We want to give it away. We want someone else to do it for us. That's what we want, right? So naturally, we are now, we want these things met. Now, a loving person's not going to meet them, is he? He's going to really trigger my fear and kingdom come. He's going to go, like, you know, by the time I finish talking with him one, you know, for a week, I'm going to be so scared, you know, that I'll be shaking my boots. I don't want to feel that. And then when it comes to the addictions, he's not going to make me feel good about myself. He's not going to make me feel nice. He's not going to make me feel like, you know, I'm a great person. You know, that's the illusion I want to maintain about myself. But he's not going to make me feel that if I'm not. Right, he's going to tell me what the problems are and he's going to be honest about it. He's not going to feed my addictions. Well, I don't want that. And then on top of that, he's going to trigger my emotions. And what do I want with that? Who wants that? That's just pain and suffering that might go on for months or years. Who wants that? Nobody. Let's go and find us a guy that won't do that. is what we do. So we're deciding that this is the person we want. And of course, God responds to desires, so we get the person we want. That's the person we really want. You follow? That's the person who we really desire in power. That's why he's in power. If we really didn't want them in power, there'd be someone else in power. There's plenty of more loving people on the planet who could be in power, but we haven't put them in power because we want this person in power. All right? But it's not a want that we're recognizing in our intellectual decision-making process. It's a want that we have emotionally that's being expressed. It's a soul-based want. There's someone tapping there. Sorry, Max. Yep. So it's what we want at the soul level. Does that make sense to you?
Yes, thank
you. That's why we're doing it. Good question to end the subject on, I think. That's the end of our day today, guys, the responsibility principle. Was that an interesting principle, yes?
Yes.
Yeah? Interesting principle. I like the whole concept that you don't have to be perfect with it. You just have to have the desire for it. Eh? It's just beautiful. We'll finish off there, but Mary wants to do some housekeeping, I gather.
I just wondered if you would like to give a special thanks to Jesus this afternoon. I feel it was... Yeah. He makes it look easy, but he's standing for a long time every day. And and I felt that he really brought his A game today, huh? Yeah. Felt a lot of you becoming really inspired, which is really beautiful.
Yeah.
And I hope you can also start to feel a little bit, I know it's been a bit challenging removing some people from this group, but there is, when there is more desire in the room, it does affect the atmosphere.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So tomorrow, I just would like to just give you a brief heads up about tomorrow. Tomorrow we're going back to that first discussion from the second day. You remember the law comparison? And what we're going to do is extend that discussion with a couple of more discussions on associated subjects and do a question and answer about that subject. And then we're going to do the last of the order principles, which is compensation, which is just a beautiful principle. So we need to cover that principle as well. And then Mary will be giving us a summary of the order principles session. So, and a bit of a heads up about the soul-specific principle session in a couple of days after that. So that's our plan. Also tomorrow morning, if you can come just a little earlier, because Lena and Igor want to invite you somewhere, so they're putting on a little show on the day off, and so they'd like to invite you along. So we'll just give you a bit of details about that in the morning, tomorrow morning. You can say it out loud.
Did you want to revisit any enforcing love and truth? Because also we might need to allow a little
bit of
time.
Well, we may do, but we'll see. Yeah. I don't see any major issues. There's only probably one person who's still living on the fence a fair bit. So that's that's something we'll address as the time comes. But
so if we make it 10:45, is that enough time, do you reckon? Or even 10:50?
Well, most of you have been here about half an hour before anyway, writing down the questions, haven't you? So we just make it normal and maybe, while people are writing down questions, I'm sure Lena and Igor can share what they would like to do and give you some details about where it is and so forth. And then we can still get started at the right time tomorrow then, at 11. And hopefully we'll finish on time, similar to how we've done today, if we do that. Yeah. Thanks for your time again today.
Thank you, everyone. Get embarrassed.
Yeah, I get embarrassed. Sorry.
Embarrassed.
It's just my issue. I've got to do it. And we'll see you tomorrow. Yep. Yep. See you.